Thank you for joining us tonight. We have the author of the book, Mutiny of Rage, which will be available on sale this weekend for the first time. This is one of his first major public appearances, Jaime Salazar. He will be participating in our program tonight. But first, I'd like to introduce Sergeant Major Clinton Warren, who will be leading part of the program tonight.
Thank you, sir. I'm Sergeant Major Clinton Warren of the 24th Infantry Regiment Battalion that was stationed down in Camp Logan. And Mr. Salazar, is a great thing for him to come in and do this book because this story needs to be told, because there's a lot of different things going on and stuff. But I think with this book, we will learn a lot of good things about his research and everything that he did. But I want to start the program off tonight with a roll call. And the roll call is Private Murphy.
Here, Sergeant Major.
Private Smith.
Here, Sergeant Major.
Corporal Baltimore. Corporal Baltimore. Corporal Charles Baltimore. Thank you.
Thank you, Sergeant Major Clinton Warren. He's an active participant in the regional Buffalo Soldier chapter. Jaime, it's so glad to have honored to have you here tonight and present you to our patrons. You begin the book with a quote from Mark Twain. Could you tell us what that quote is and why you selected it?
Right. I think it kind of gives the reader a feel of what the book is going to entail. It basically says, history doesn't rhyme, but it has a tendency to rhyme. Sorry, I think I said that wrong. History doesn't repeat itself, but it sure does rhyme. And I think we see that in this book, because we tend to retell the same stories with a slightly different twist.
What motivated you to write this book? And when did you discover you had a book?
Right. I discovered pretty soon that I had a book. Interestingly enough, I approached my law professor from law school, and I asked him what some of the interesting things he was working on. Obviously, I was kicking around ideas of something that I might consider writing a book on, and he told me that the school itself was doing considerable amounts of legal work on behalf of the deceased Buffalo soldiers, trying to get their convictions overturned and trying to get them obviously pardoned posthumously. And that immediately struck me as a really interesting idea for a book. I looked into it further, and I clearly was pretty typical of most Houstonians. I might have heard about the events. I heard that there's something happened 100 years ago, a couple of soldiers did some bad things in the city, but I really wasn't all that aware. So the more research I did, the more I realized, wow, this is a really interesting story, and this is something that really should be told. So that's really kind of when I realized, okay, yeah, I think I've definitely got something here and something that's important.
Well, I've written a number of magazine articles before, and I've started some of them and realized I really didn't have anything to say. So I abandoned it and went on to the next article. Right. When did you realize you had something to say?
Knowing the totality of the situations, I realized I could write volumes on this. I mean, there was so much there, and there were so many different angles I could go about writing this book. So I knew the question of would I be able to write a book, yeah, that was never a question. Now, obviously, would the book sell, right? Would I be able to get this published? Does it have enough public interest that I could be successful in this? That certainly was a different question, but in terms of material, yeah. I mean, it was more about what would I not include. I mean, there's you can go a pretty long way just talking about this topic. So I think I was lucky in that sense.
History has been very silent on this significant event. Why?
Right. You know, that's actually one of the interesting questions that I think about, especially when I was writing the book. And even with all the material that I've researched and all the discussions I've had, nobody really asks that question, all right? And secondly, no one is really prepared to answer that question. So I might be really kind of the first one to pose my own theories on why that is the case.
And they are?
Well, it's not an answer that's really going to please a lot of people. But I would honestly posit that, as evidenced in my book, this was a difficult historical moment in time. Neither side comes out looking all that good. There was evil on both sides, all right? And I think for that reason, there's been somewhat of a tacit agreement that, listen, if you don't talk about this, we won't talk about this, all right? And we'll just kind of pretend it never happened. And I think whether that's done on a conscious level or on a collective level, there's emotions going on that kind of push us in that direction. And obviously with me writing this book, it wasn't my intent to pass an ultimate judgment on what exactly happened. My job was just to tell the story.
Talk about the relationship of honor to the events that you described.
That was a pivotal driving force for the Buffalo Soldiers, right? And I think people who haven't served in the military or perhaps are not familiar with the military lifestyle, honor is an integral part of who you are as a soldier. And you had a situation where you had a group of soldiers, very proud soldiers, who served their country. They've done very difficult things. They've done what they were told to do, and they served their country with honor. They were challenged in ways, and they were treated in ways that challenged their notions of honor. And in the end of the day, you can only push so far before you have what happened, before you have retaliation, before you have mutiny, before you have mass hysteria and mayhem. If the soldiers were to have been treated with more honor, I think we would have had a very different result. And I think the instigators of the rioting should have known that they were treading on dangerous territory when they were harassing soldiers that were very proud, and for most opinions were serving honorably.
The many of your passages are violent and descriptively with descriptive imagery.
Right.
How did you toy with the idea of toning it down or really laying the cards out about what happened?
Right. I didn't shy away from the gratuitous violence. I in fact, I made it a point to not spare the reader of what really happened. And I think, to me as a writer, and you could argue as an artist, you want to express events as true to life as they really are. And obviously in film and in print, we tend to get a story that's not entirely accurate, that's fictionalized, or the rough edges are kind of sanded away. In this case, I really wanted to in fact shock the audience with the realism of what actually happened, and certainly not gloss over the uglier bits, because I think that's what really certainly makes the story authentic, and it brings the reader closer to what happened.
Let's talk about the question that's been around for thousands of years, and that's the question of evil. How does Mutiny of Rage address this?
That's a question we're not going to be able to answer today. But I will say this about evil. I think the most intelligent thing I could say about evil is that it comes in on cat's paws. And by that I mean that it sneaks up on you, and before you know it, you become that thing that you abhor You become the thing that you feared. You become the thing that was tormenting you. And that's one of the cruxes of this book, is how evil penetrated the most pious of people, and it turned them into murderers. And you can even argue that evil existed, and you had innocence marching into evil, and they were transformed in ways that they themselves did not recognize. So the notion of innocence tarnished by evil is one of the things that I brought out in this book.
And you did so very well.
Thank you.
The guns and blacks. This was an incendiary topic.
Absolutely.
Even World War II.
Yes.
Many blacks were prohibited from having guns.
Right.
Can you address that issue?
Yes. Yes, and it's incendiary even today, because obviously guns are an incendiary political topic in today's political conversations. And I'm not going to pass judgment on that. I'm not going to make any proclamations about that. But what we can all agree upon is that blacks, in many ways, have been pushed around both sides of that issue, right? You have people who are arguing that blacks should not have guns, or more generally that you should try to eliminate guns in the inner cities and so forth. You have that argument, and then you also have a more antiquated argument that blacks are the people who precisely should have guns, because they are being targeted, because they are they're minorities and they need protection. So in the very least, I would like to present this issue as far more complex than the way we paint it in today's political climate. It's far more complex, and for either side to basically claim that the black sentiment is with their cause, I think does a great injustice, because this is a very, very historical. It's a very complex idea. It's a little bit of be careful what you wish for, because you might get it, right? And if you want to either disarm certain groups, certain minority groups, if you think you're being benevolent by protecting them against themselves or against unseen enemies, you could have consequences that you aren't happy with.
The first third of the book, I was 1,000% sympathetic and compassionate with the Buffalo Soldiers and what had happened to them.
Right.
And then the next third of the book, my sympathies didn't evaporate, but they were revised. And because you cited the case of the father of six children being an innocent bystander being murdered. Three minors were severely injured, and I believe one for life. You had a Hispanic laborer who had just gotten off the streetcar, and he was shot. There was indiscriminate shooting going on. But then, in the last third of your book, you laid the case that probably 99% of the people who were participated did not pull the trigger. Can you address that?
The way the events happened allowed me to take the reader on a roller coaster ride. And I think I must have watched one too many Netflix documentaries where they really pull a 360 on you with, you know, who ended up doing it, the way the story was structured. But in this case, the facts simply lend themselves to this idea. And of course, when I was researching the book, I also was in your same shoes. I found myself partially biased towards one side, going towards the other, and eventually just being confused with where does the fault lie? Okay, where does the truth lie? The famous Latin verse, qui dis veritas, right? What is truth? And that's eventually what we are seeking. So the original question I think you had is, was it the case that you had a few bad apples? Yeah, that's how I would describe it. You had a few bad apples that did bad things. You had a lot of young men who were probably scared, who were following orders, and they got circled into this. So as you can imagine, this is not a clear-cut book that provides a lot of answers. In fact, I think it's probably going to provide more questions. It's going to leave people a little slightly more confused about an event that had a lot of different layers, a lot of different actors in there, and a lot of very morally ambiguous situations.
The book weaves and incorporates a number of ancient events such as occurred in Greek history and Roman history with the Hebrews and the Christians. And you very beautifully weave it into the beginning of the chapter or sometimes the end of the chapter. And it was almost like, how many books did he read to prepare for this book? Can you tell us how the lessons learned from the ancient Greeks and the Romans and the Hebrews and the Christians apply to this book?
I'm a firm believer that there's nothing new under the sun. And obviously that was a phrase taken from the Bible. I think it makes perfect sense. The reason we're informed by these ancient fables, verbal, oral traditions, and so forth, is because human beings haven't really changed a whole lot in the past 5,000 years. And just when we think we've seen it all, that thing had occurred many thousand years ago, and the Greeks wrote about it. So I also believe that as an author, you not only have to be good at writing, obviously your product has to be entertaining, has to be of a high quality, but to be a good writer, you have to be a good reader. And I have done my best to really inform myself. And most of this certainly wasn't work. I would say that I'm slightly more curious than most people. I really enjoy investigating things, going down rabbit holes in history, going down rabbit holes in literature, and really kind of immersing myself in abstract facts. People who know me enjoy being around me on trivia night at the local pub. So these kinds of things fascinate me. But at the same time, this allowed me to really be able to gauge the events, the factual events, with things that already occurred, or things that authors, ancient authors wrote about, things that Shakespeare wrote about. I think to one of my favorite authors, Jorge Luis Borges. He was an Argentinian author who wrote kind of metaphysical books that I really enjoyed. And as a young man, I mean, he was digging into Norse sagas. I mean, just very, very deep sort of stuff. I might go as deep as Shakespeare, you know, several hundred years ago, but you can go as far back as you want. And the real skill is bringing that out, putting it back onto the paper in an entertaining way, in a way that really kind of makes sense. So I hope I did a good job in doing that.
I once attended a lecture by George Will, and there was a college student there, and he raised his hand. He said, "I want to be a writer. What's your best advice?" And I kind of perked up because he had written a number of award-winning books, and one of which was on baseball. Right. And so I was expecting all this cogent and deep analysis, and he answered the question with three words: lots of reading.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's the homework part of the job. Yeah, that's the part that's less glamorous.
Tell us about the structure of the book and how you went about telling the story. Now, you alluded to an earlier question, how it was like, for me, a roller coaster. I was taken to one end of the highway and the runway and taken to the other end of the football field and down to the down center part of town. And at the end of the book, my head was spinning because I didn't know what to believe.
Right. Right. The interesting part about writing a book, and you might even say the most fiendishly difficult part, and I think most authors would agree, especially if they're working on a nonfiction historical work, is collating mountains of data. And that was my challenge. I mean, I had mountains of data. I had storylines that went in wild directions, storylines that might even, that were parallel, and then maybe they weren't germane to it, lots of different characters. So the challenge really is organizational, right? It's not necessarily being creative, being an excellent creative writer. Really, you are an archivist, putting together scraps of information, right? Dead Sea Scrolls, you might consider the job that they had in putting this together. That's pretty much the job that I was faced with in writing this book. Thankfully, I relied a lot upon my legal training and my ability to produce legal writing. Interesting story about legal writing is that I graduated from law school roughly 5 years ago. And prior to law school, I had already published my first book. And going into legal writing, which is kind of a first year course, I was absolutely confident that I would get the A+. I would get the top score in my class because I published a book. I know how to write. Okay. I had no idea. I struggled just to pass that class. Little did I know, I really had no idea how to write until I got through law school, and that really showed me how to write. And what it did is it allowed me to structure my thoughts and to present ideas in a very clear and cogent way. So I think the people with a legal background who read my book, they will recognize a lot of the structures that I used, a lot of the methodology that I used, a lot of the approaches I took to addressing topics. They'll recognize that as probably something that was taught in their first and second year writing classes. But I'm thankful that I had that to fall back on and create a book that was pretty clear and pretty cogent. So to the reader, he's not going to notice this. It reads perfectly clear, and they go on a very interesting ride. Getting there as the author was hell, but it was a labor of love.
Preparing the research for tonight, I read your book, but I wanted to see what other sources were available on the subject. And I, much to my amazement, I could count on one hand what's been written both in books and in magazines and academic articles and so forth. I was shocked, actually.
Right.
So how did your legal research skills allow you facilitate the process of digging up materials that had never been seen the light of the day since 1917? And what makes your book different from some of the other articles and books that have been written?
That's a good question. And I'll have to dovetail on what you said. There isn't, to this day, there isn't a whole lot of material on this historical event. There is one academic work by Professor Haynes, who did a very good job on this. And to answer the question in a nutshell, how mine is different, mine is readable. Mine is not an academic work. It's obviously filled with the important facts and the important research. But my aim wasn't to detail every single precise moment of this event and to preserve it as a historical archive. Because my aim as a nonfiction writer is to present a story that people are going to read, people are going to appreciate, and people can internalize. So that was my challenge, was to really take what was ponderous academic research, write it in a way that's digestible, that's entertaining, and that flows. So the artistry of the writer was evident when I got to work, because I was dealing with a lot of different material. So aside from one or two books that were written on this topic, I went to the archives. I went to the legal archives, thanks to the hard work at the from the folks at South Texas College of Law, which is the law school that I went to. They did a really good job of including all these archives. Some of them were only recently released, so I was dealing with a lot of new information, and the depth of information that I had access to was profound. I mean, you had almost every single legal document surrounding the trial on each and every defendant, arguably on probably even individuals who weren't involved in the actual riot. But there was all the, it was all the information surrounding that. There was different legal briefs that were written. So a lot of this material simply wasn't available 20, 30 years ago.
Was it suppressed?
I wouldn't say it was suppressed. I think some of the Army archives were just collecting dust, and it was just a matter of them releasing those. I am not for sure, but there's a good chance there was a FOIA request made. By the way, FOIA is a Freedom of Information Act. Request might have been made for those. And like I said, it just took a fresh set of eyes to really look at some of the new material and bring it to light. Not only that, I mean, obviously my book is standing on the shoulder of giants. There was a lot of shorter works written. There was a lot of research I did on the Buffalo Soldiers as a whole, and they almost always included a few pages on the events in Houston, Texas. So that really helped. So I was really chasing around a lot of different material and getting stuff from a lot of different sources and putting it together in a way that was seamless and cogent.
Well, you seem to have two books, one legal and one historical, and I liked them both. The historical was well documented, and the legal, I have read many legal briefs in my life, and almost all have put me to sleep. I actually yours was actually very engaging. And I think one of the things you probably did for the reader was able to make it cogent that a lawyer could say, he's done his homework, but make it with clarity for the layman to also read it. And certainly in the last third of the book, that was evident, because that's when the trials occurred. And it was very obvious that you put your law license on the table here to write that last third of the book. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, that's a very good observation. The person I think we all think of when we think of a legal thriller, John Grisham. All right, and not everyone likes John Grisham. Even a lot of legal experts don't necessarily like his style of writing. So I was careful to really be respectful of the legal process and not glossing over events that are significant. And at the same time, balancing that with not weighing down the reader with legal minutiae or dicta, as they say in legal circles. So that was the challenge that I was faced with. In terms of the structure, you're absolutely right. It is almost two books. You could maybe even argue three books, two and a half books. You've got the events, right? And the last person dies kind of halfway in the book without giving away the story. And then you have kind of the aftermath, the trial. And I think back to the films that I saw, you know, the To Kill a Mockingbird, for example. A Few Good Men, the 1992 movie with Tom Cruise, that was based on incidents that occurred with a few Marines, and the second half of the movie was basically just the trial. So this is a format that's been used before, and it's one that I decided to go with. Telling the story and then kind of circling back around through a circuitous route, explaining what happened legally. So that was really kind of a challenge. But in a sense, that was, I think, the best way to really tell the story, to separate these two things. And again, I think that's related also to my obsessive compulsive habits when it comes to writing and to putting topics in different categories. Different boxes, exploring that topic completely, moving on to the next topic, the next subject matter with the header and subtitles. So for the fiction snobs who or the folks in the creative writing departments, that might not be to their taste, But again, to a reader who appreciates crispness and clarity, I think that's doing them a service, and I think it worked with you. So
it was most engaging from the beginning of the book to the last page. And I couldn't put it down at night. You cost me a night's sleep, by the way. Tell us how Corporal Baltimore was both a victim and maybe an aggressor.
Yes. He's one of the more interesting characters in the book. There's no question about that. And obviously he's one of the pivotal characters of the events that we're talking about. But what makes his story interesting is the fact that he was arguably the lightning rod for the events that happened. He was the corporal that was beaten by the police, and that event sparked the rioting that caused the soldiers to go out and rampage on the city of Houston. He was innocent and didn't deserve to be treated the way he was. What makes his story more complicated, and when we start to get into the muddy gray areas, is when he participated wholeheartedly in the rioting, and he became, you might say, he was infected by that evil, by this all-encompassing sort of contagion of this evil that comes in on cat's paws. He was a perfect example of how that happens. And he's also a perfect example of you might say, the anti-hero. There's a few anti-heroes in this book, obviously, without giving away too many names. That's what really makes this book interesting, is the vagueness and
the ambiguity.
And the ambiguity. You're riding on a roller coaster. You know, what happened? What and why would the victim become the victimizer? And then the victim again. There's a lot.
For the audience, for the virtual audience, you had very clearly documented how the verbal abuse that these soldiers had endured. And many of them had been in the Philippines and served in the Filipino-American War.
Right.
Some of them had seen action on the frontier, and they weren't used to being treated with such disrespect.
Right.
From what I gather in your book, they didn't like it, but they endured it. The lightning rod came when two of their brothers were severely beaten for some minor, if that, offense. Who knows what it was. In any other circles, they'd just be told to go home. But they were severely beaten. That was the lightning rod that sparked the event. And from what I can tell, 99% of the people had not planned on what had happened that night during the rage. And some of them even tried to peel off and go back to base. And as I understand it, they were told if they did, they'd be shot. Although some did make it back.
Right.
Can you tell us about that?
Right. I'll start off with the Philippines. The Buffalo soldiers had seen exemplary service in the Philippines. And the interesting thing about the life of a soldier is that you ask any serviceman, even to this day, what were the finest moments of your time in the military? And almost all of them will say, when I was posted overseas or when I was in combat. These are really the moments that exemplify the spirit of the serviceman or woman. And it goes back to the topic that we were talking about briefly, about honor. And related to honor is the idea of saving face. And I think if the instigating parties had respected that and would have treated these men with the reverence that they were owed as servicemen who had served overseas with honor, a lot of these events could have been avoided. So they challenged the honor of these soldiers, and that didn't end well. And obviously, hubris and honor are things that tend to get passionate men into trouble. And that's what we have in this case. Now, the fact that you did have a lot of men who were kind of roped in because they were following the Pied Piper, you might say, is pretty accurate. And that gets to the tragic part of the story, which is the idea that there were men who probably should not have been convicted, that there were men who probably did not participate, but who were treated with the same swiftness and harshness that the guilty parties were. And that's the tragic part of the story.
The it was almost like a tornado. A tornado, you hear it coming, and you wait for it to come, and you're wondering whether it's going to come to your house or the next street, because I've been near tornadoes. And then when it arrives, it does its damage, then it's over.
Right.
But it does a lot of damage.
Right.
This event probably had been some of it. We don't know how much of it was premeditated.
Right.
The testimony varies. But the it only lasted for 2 hours.
Correct.
But when you read the book, it seemed like it lasted for days. Right. But when you get through, this was all in 2 hours, this whole thing, right. The shootings and the so forth. And then, of course, the trial. Normally, in capital offense trials, certainly today, they take several years for the prosecutor to build the case. And in this case, wasn't it about the trials took place in November, and this took place in August?
Correct.
So we're talking a period of 2 to 3 months. And I was, of course, appalled at the procedures of evidence. I don't know what the precise legal term is, but it seemed like they would ask this witness to come testify, and who started this? And he would point to one person. These are government witnesses. And then they bring in another one, and he'd point to another person. So the evidence, if I was a trial judge, I would have been questioning that right there. Wait a minute. Two different people are pointing to two different people as the culprit.
Correct.
That would, to me as a judge, that would automatically be a strike. Any, as a lawyer, what's your comment on that?
Right. I would agree with you. And I think most fair-minded people would, who know the second half of the book, which is kind of the legal proceedings, the trial that followed the events, they would say confidently that the trial at the very least was rushed. There were corners that were cut. There was sloppiness in a lot of the procedure. This led to the feelings of injustice, and this is one of the core parts of the book, is the idea that the soldiers didn't get a fair trial, that there were things that were done that weren't in line with procedure or with military justice at that time. Things that hindsight we can obviously see today that would have swayed the verdicts in one direction or the other. So I wholeheartedly agree. That's exactly what happened.
And the prosecutor's main argument was, if one's guilty, they're all guilty.
Correct.
And that's more in the book. As I said, the first third of the book, I was 1,000% sympathetic. Then it went down a little bit in the second third, because that's when innocent people were killed. And then in the third of the book, the last third, my sympathies went back up because I'm not a lawyer, but this looked like a kangaroo court. Right. And I don't know what the definition of kangaroo court, but mine is it's a sloppy job.
Right.
The most biggest red flag for me was the fact that they did not have proper legal representation, i.e. a practiced trial attorney. Can you comment on that?
Yes. The legal expert representing the soldiers, the Buffalo soldiers who were on trial, was not a licensed lawyer. He actually taught law at West Point. You could argue that he was an experienced legal scholar. He wasn't a licensed lawyer. He was chosen by the judge advocate general. So he was appointed. He wasn't selected by the Buffalo soldiers. That there is problematic to begin with. All right. Which leads to the question, did they have the opportunity to object? And secondly, what would have been their recourse if they did object to having a non-attorney representing them? And I think the recourse they had if they chose not to be represented by their appointed lawyer is, well, you can go pay for your own lawyer. That was a non-issue for these men. They were impoverished servicemen. So that opens the door to questions of, was this proper? All right. And were they truly able to comprehend the fact that they may in fact have been getting substandard legal representation? The other big fact indicating that they did not get a fair trial was the fact that their legal representative, Major Greer, he only had 2 weeks to prepare for trial. And that's absolutely insane. I mean, any legal professional would tell you that's lightning speed. Somehow there was no objection to this. And that
especially since he was representing 100 people.
Absolutely. Yeah, 2 weeks to prepare a defense for 100 people. That's absolutely unheard of. Absolutely unheard of. And this, to this day, is considered perhaps the trial of the century. So, yeah, on its face, there were serious problems with the trial.
I don't want to give too much of the book away because I'd like for them to read the book.
Yes.
And I'm going to ask these two questions in tandem. One is, when you describe the executions, you first of all, one of the sergeants, or one of the privates, I believe, was able to mail a letter to his mother a few days before the execution. I believe he was the only one that was able to do that. And possibly he was, and it was a beautiful letter. I mean, it wasn't, it had poetry in it. And I guess where my heart went out, just by reading the letter, I do not feel he was guilty. And then you used some biblical references, and also you mentioned that they were all singing Christian hymns when they were being hung. How did that make you feel when you realized they were singing Christian hymns while they were being hung?
That was a very powerful moment in researching the book. And it was such a powerful moment. And that was one of the reasons why the book is tinged with a lot of Christian metaphor, a lot of Christian references.
And why?
Because these were arguably all, if not most, of these soldiers were probably devout Christians, which was normal for the time, especially for descendants of the slaves. These tended to be very pious people. So this was the oeuvre of their experience. These were deeply religious men who were involved in sinful acts. They might not have committed them, but there was a great evil. The town of Houston was visited by the evil one on that particular evening. These were men who were wanting to expiate their guilt, their sins, wanting to expiate their sins, and they were about to meet their maker. So this was a thing that I carried on with me throughout the book. And the faith of these men was very beautiful, as you mentioned. They were singing before they were about to be hung, and they were talking with the guards, talking about how they're going to be catch up with them on the other side, and so forth. So it's very, very sort of heart-rending stuff. And I think it adds a richness, and I think it adds the human element to these servicemen. And it paints a different picture of what people might think were bloodthirsty killers.
From what I can gather from the testimony and the old legal term preponderance of the evidence, no one was clearly identified as the killer.
That's an accurate statement. The interesting thing about the trial, or you might even say the outstanding thing about the trial, was the fact that there was no, arguably there was no smoking gun to put on exhibit. There was no exhibit A of the guilt. You could compare it to in legal terms, we call it preponderance of the evidence, or a lot of different events sort of piled up, and you say, okay, I think I'm swayed 85% that this happened, and so forth. So it was a lot of different things that the arbitrators had to decide, judge their guilt. In my opinion, I don't believe what we call the pile of evidence was persuasive for the sentences that these men received. So the trial, you might say, could be summed up in, was it persuasive? Would it have convinced a jury today or a tribunal that these men were guilty? That's the big question. And that's what this book addresses. But you're absolutely right. There was no smoking gun. And on an interesting side note, I mentioned slightly, a little bit in the book, there could be men who took their secrets with them to the grave. They talk about the conspiracy of silence. You know, these men that swore up and down that they would not let go of their secrets. Was that real, or was that an exaggeration by the prosecution? It's tough to say. It's tough to say. You know, we think of like the old crime boss, the old mafia bosses who will sit in prison for 50 years and never peep a word. That's a lot. That's a lot. And the point that you brought up about the, I think it was Private Hawkins who wrote the letter, the very beautiful letter. In the letter itself, he said, I'm not guilty of these actions. Okay. This letter was written at the time when he knew he was going to be hung. You could argue that most people, if they knew this is it, this is the end of the line, they would come clean. All right. None of them actually did. So, and especially Private Hawkins, that's pretty strong evidence that things weren't quite as they were presented.
Another little detail you mentioned, there was one of the soldiers that contracted pneumonia, so he had to go to the hospital and miss the trial.
Right.
Well, it's a good thing, because he might have been convicted.
Yeah.
And I thought, if pneumonia gets you out of the trial, that's kind of a...
It did seem strange. Yeah, it did seem strange, and there wasn't a lot more information on that. We don't know if he actually sort of was incapacitated from the pneumonia. That's a little bit of a question mark. But that seemed a little bit odd, considering the thoroughness of the prosecution.
Well, fortunately for him, he did contract the pneumonia, because. Now, in today's terms, they'd get you well, and then you go back to trial.
Yeah, that's kind of how it works. It's a respite.
One part of the trial I kind of smirked at or smiled at is when one person argued that women and alcohol were the cause of this, and they shouldn't have let those women on the base. And my first reaction was, well, most of them were looking for husbands. The Buffalo Soldier was a good catch. A, they had demonstrated discipline. B, they had demonstrated stability by being in the service for a number of years, most of them. And it, in sexist terms, they painted them as harlots. And, of course, that was incendiary information to put in the press for the Times.
Yeah, that was an interesting aspect of this story. I think since the days of Adam, whenever things go south, you blame the wife. Okay. You spill paint, the kids spill paint in the garage. Well, it's, you know, because you didn't raise them. You raised them not to pay attention to those kinds of things. That's kind of the unfortunate arc of history. In this case, I would summarize those actions as grabbing at straws, because it was a pretty weak argument, and they were really, really kind of stretching it on this one. And the argument was, for those who don't know, the argument was that the black females, the black young ladies of Houston, were smuggling in alcohol. Okay, I mean, as if that was a huge felony. I mean, especially since these men were probably at least over 18, probably potentially over 21. And somehow that riled them up into a frenzy and motivated them to do unspeakable things. Now, one of the prime voices that was pushing this theory was were the prohibitionists, or the teetotalers. And obviously they have a vested interest to demonize alcohol. So I think that was a very weak argument, not only because I think they're obviously grabbing at straws, but the nature of alcohol doesn't necessarily lead one to go rampage on a city. You know, if we look at, you know, the child soldiers in Africa today, for example, they're pumped up with stimulants, all right, methamphetamines and so forth, to really animate them and get them to do things they normally wouldn't do. Alcohol, it just isn't one of those things. And at the same time, they were looking for scapegoats in a particular group of a particular demographic, that being the young black women. They were looking to scapegoat them when, in fact, these women were either innocent or, in fact, they had actually mitigated a lot of the potential harm that was done. Because a lot of these young women were reporting back to the authorities that these men are riled up. They're about to do something crazy. Do something about this. Cause
so the women were doing the right thing.
You could actually argue they were doing the right thing, and they were scapegoated. You know, this and this poor woman, Sarah Travers, was also scapegoated as a woman of ill repute, and so forth. So, yeah, the kind of the sleazy side of the legal process of the trial was that they painted it with a very broad brush. They were lassoing in a lot of people that had no business being accused.
I think this modern psychologists call it transference? This one is guilty, but you blame that one.
Right.
And it's an avoidance of their own responsibilities of what a number of the white policemen had, the disrespect that was exhibited by the policemen towards the black soldiers. And so we don't want to take responsibility for our own misgivings, so we blame it on the women. You know,
right.
I almost smirked at that. I said, that's probably the weakest argument I've read so far about it from any side. And I said, you need to take a look at your own inventory before you blame it on the women.
Absolutely.
Can you comment on the fact that, first of all, your credentials are impressive? You speak 3.5 languages, one of which is French, one of which is Spanish, one of which is English, and apparently Latin. Because you profusely use Latin and say it correctly.
All right.
So you're an engineer.
I am.
And you're an attorney. You're the first American-born generation in your family. And you're writing a book about, that involves African-American history. So you have a Hispanic writing about African-American history. From my perspective, that's a wonderful multicultural exchange. Have you had any comments or questions by anybody saying, why are you writing this book?
Not yet.
Good.
I don't know how long that's going to last.
Well, from my perspective, I don't care what your heritage is. If you're doing the research, and which you did, do you care to guess how many hours of research you did for this book?
Gosh, that's a really good question. I will say this. I will say this, that rewind a year and everyone was cooped up in their homes wearing masks and watching Netflix or playing video games in a general state of panic. I was going buck wild writing this book and just churning out pages and pages of material. So that was actually an opportunity for me to really focus in on this particular labor of love.
So the pandemic allowed you to write a book.
It certainly did. It certainly did. And of course the events of the pandemic kind of weighed with me. And in the dedication to the book, it was to the people who are suffering at this time. Of course, you had the racial riots spiking what was already a very, very difficult year. So, yeah, these were the best of days. They were the worst of days, like Dickens says.
The what's your next book?
That is a good question. That's something I'm definitely kicking around, and I will be having to go on a journey and see what's out there. You know, as a storyteller, I'm always looking out for the next interesting story. And I'm also not one to rest my laurels. I think it was very soon after I submitted the final draft to the publisher for this book that I was thinking, okay, well, what do I do now? Okay, you know, what's next? I was kind of in a panic in that sense. So I certainly hope to continue the process and continue to tell stories, to really bring events to America's living room. I think that's the essence of what a nonfiction writer really is. They want to tell stories that need to be told.
I once read a book on the French Foreign Legion.
Right.
And I probably would have been tossed out the first day. The rugged, tough, the training was brutal. And then they were hauled off to North Africa where there was no water and expected to work in 120-degree heat. And I don't mean just sitting around, working hard and oftentimes fighting, you know, which is brutal itself. And I have, of course, read a number of things on the Buffalo Soldiers starting with the Civil War all the way up through the American West, and they were taken off to places like Arizona where there was similar conditions like the Foreign Legion, no water, hot, desolate, absolutely no amenities whatsoever. Can you compare the Buffalo Soldiers and the French Foreign Legion?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I dovetailed lightly a lot of these two different armies. I even mentioned the Spanish Foreign Legion. And the reason being is that since the Romans, we've had sort of what you might call throwaway armies, the expendables, and so forth. The Foreign Legion, without question, is probably one of the most famous armies of expendables, of men who you can send off and fight and not have to worry too much about if they don't come back. The problem with that And the reason it dovetails with the Buffalo Soldiers is that the Buffalo Soldiers were treated much the same way as were these other armies. They were given jobs that were undesirable. They were packed off to foreign, desolate places in the Wild West, fighting the most tenacious Native American tribes in the West. They had it rough. And they also knew that they had it rough. So that certainly had a morale-sapping effect on the troops. So you have a really kind of a toxic mix. And I also mentioned about the Foreign Legion in the 1960s. They actually rebelled against General Charles de Gaulle, and they were preparing to invade France to kind of establish their own puppet state based on this renegade army. So the point I'm making is that if you don't mind, if you don't give your troops proper care, if you treat them like throwaway armies, it can come back and bite you. And the infant that you birth from that might not be something that you like. And that's something that I wanted to bring about in this book. And that's, that bit of research was something that I produced solely on my own. None of that obviously was in the research I've done that was particularly germane to the Buffalo Soldiers. That was just kind of an extra layer of a lot of different layers, a lot of different themes that I implemented in this book. So with a bit of luck, we have something of a book that's like a croissant with various different layers, all kind of related to each other, but all germane to the main story.
Well, of course, most people are familiar with the Beau Jest with Gary Cooper and so right. forth, but and there were definitely elements of that movie in real life, but the Buffalo Soldiers had distinguished themselves in every conflict that America's ever been in since the American Revolution. And during World War I, they provided the pioneer units, built the bridges built the roads in France and Germany, so the tanks and the wagons and the other vehicles could travel. And so they had a record, an exemplary record of contributions to American history. And when I read the book, at first I had the concern that this was going to blemish their history. And it's kind of like you have this glowing record and then you have this little bit of a flaw over here. But I admired the way you handled it, because the book was left with, there are no answers except one, and that's evil begets evil. Retribution, it's a downward spiral, and no one wins. Can you comment?
Cain and Abel. Something that was going so perfectly well can become so corrupted, and tragedy befalls the characters in much the same. Hundreds of stories like that in the Bible, right? They parallel this absolutely clearly. And I think your analysis of evil begets evil is pretty accurate, pretty accurate. It comes in on cat's paws, and before you know it, you are the one engaging in the evil.
It appears that, as we've said earlier, that we don't know what most of them were told before they left the base. We don't know whether they were told to do this or that, or things just got out of hand suddenly. But we do know that there's testimony that most of the people that attended the march were forced to. And that's a very important point of your book. They weren't necessarily there because of choice.
Right.
They faced consequences if they didn't participate.
Right.
Can you comment?
Yeah. That's a darn good question. And it was even in the court transcripts. You had testimony from Buffalo soldiers who were in this raid that clearly said, look, there were senior servicemen forcing us to participate in this march. All right. Many of them had no idea that they were actually going to go out and kill people. All right. So this was made pretty clear in the court proceedings. I don't know why that was not given more weight by the adjudicators.
That was my thought. Why was that not given weight?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's the first question.
Because even Nuremberg trials, ordered to was the number one argument.
Yeah.
And a lot of lives were spared in Nuremberg because people realized, yeah, if they had refused to follow orders, they themselves would have been shot.
Yeah.
Now, they might have been put in prison, but they were spared their lives.
Yeah.
I mean, over and over at Nuremberg, because I've read many of the trials, I was forced to. Does that exonerate yourself? Not necessarily, but that was my first realization in life that sometimes you have to make painful decisions. And at the Nuremberg trials, mercy was shown, not always, but sometimes. Why wasn't that shown in Houston? Well, the trials were held in San Antonio, as I recall. Right. Why was that same mercy not shown in San Antonio when they were shown at Nuremberg?
Yeah, yeah, that's a very good question. I think what's most germane to your question is the fact that there were similar crimes committed by white servicemen and they were not given the same sentence. So that on its face is reason to believe that they were not given a fair trial. I mean, prima facie, as we say. The Nuremberg trials are interesting because they do open up an ethical Pandora's box that is very difficult to parse out. And anyone who's taken a basic ethics class at university is posed with these questions. You know, you've got the train on the track and you've got the lever, so forth. Most of us kind of relegate these as things that exist in theory, but we're never ever going to be presented with this. Well, the book clearly demonstrates that you are posed with these very difficult situations. These are not just hypotheticals that you discuss in a philosophy lecture hall. These are real things. And we saw that. And we saw the fact that you had individuals going one way, you had individuals kind of going the other way. But one of the hypotheticals that was discussed, and to this day, I'm not quite sure if there's closure, is the idea of collective guilt. Okay. Going back to the Nuremberg trials, they discussed the idea of whether the German nation was beholden to collective guilt, right? I mean, an uncomfortable fact that most of us don't really think about too often is what percent of Nazis actually killed another human being? Well, it's probably not that many. But we would argue that the Nazis en masse are bad people. So as applied to the Buffalo Soldiers trial, I think the way they approached these legal questions was balancing the interests. They split the baby. Which is arguably kind of the worst way to address these problems. It was a fudge.
The case went, and this is after the hangings, the case went to President Woodrow Wilson, and an investigation ensued. And he actually gave clemency, I believe, to 5 people. And then the sentences were greatly reduced from hangings to 20 years in prison and so forth. And then each successive president, Harding and Coolidge and FDR, gave a few more leniencies and a few more commutations, and And by the 30s, I believe they were all released. And so consequently, there was some sort of change of will in the public that even though we hid this for the last 100 years, there was still, there seemed to be more sympathy from the American public towards the situation by the commutations and the clemencies that were granted all the way from Wilson to FDR. Is that your take on it, that the American people were more sympathetic, and as such, the presidents that followed were more sympathetic?
Yes to all of those. Like they say, the arc of history bends towards justice. Now, it might be a slight bend, but you could argue that it bends a little bit towards justice. And I think in the decades that followed since the events of that night, you did have a softening of the public opinion on what should be done to these men. The other aspect that you didn't quite mention is the success that black activism had in raising awareness for the lives of these men. And interestingly enough, I briefly cover a lot of the social movements that were birthed from this military event, you might say, a thing involving black soldiers. However, the activism and so forth that started from this really kind of graduated into bigger and better things in the 60s and so forth, in the civil rights movement and so forth. So a lot of things happened. NAACP, it came into its own during the trial, in the aftermath of the mutiny. So kudos to black activism 100 years ago. They were successful in bringing this to the attention of the American public. And of course it was politically incendiary for each successive president, not just Wilson. Wilson obviously has a dubious reputation for a number of reasons. In this particular instance, I think he behaved in an exemplary way in showing clemency towards these soldiers. Mixed legacy again.
Because the sentences in the second, third trial were a lot less.
Yes.
And a lot less severe.
Yeah.
And I can't help but think that came from President Wilson and the Secretary Baker. Do we know what General Pershing, if he weighed in on this at all?
I don't know a whole lot of his activity, and I don't know if he had a significant role in this. He's in the book, obviously. He was an interesting character. Also with the mixed legacy with regards to black servicemen.
Well, for our virtual audience, General Pershing had commanded Buffalo Soldiers, I believe, in New Mexico.
In Mexico.
Oh, in Mexico.
In Mexico, yeah. The
and found them to be highly disciplined and very talented.
Yes.
And very passionate. And so he had a great deal of respect for them. However, at the time of Camp Logan, he was in Europe supervising that situation. So I doubt he was able to weigh in at the time, but maybe after the war, I wondered if he'd ever made a comment one way or the other.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to know. I don't know of anything.
I couldn't find anything. I looked, but that doesn't mean it's not there.
Yeah.
The volume of his papers could fill up this auditorium, and I don't have time to read them all.
Absolutely.
But nevertheless, what are the lessons learned? Our last few questions tonight. For me, and I know that's easy because I'm sitting 104 years away from the event, but failure to communicate, failure to have an appeals process, failure to have context, and failure to try to understand each other are the lessons that we need to learn from that event, not for 1917, but for 2021 and the future. Can you comment?
Yes, certainly. We're relearning the lessons from history. And arguably, these are things that we should have learned a long time ago. And it, either we unlearn them or we just ignore the results. For instance, you could argue that the Buffalo soldiers were political prisoners. You could make that argument, right? That they were victims of a judicial system that did not do its job. Or you could argue that the judicial system was flawed to begin with, right? Garbage in, garbage out, right? If the system itself was flawed, you're going to get a flawed result, so forth. You could make both of those arguments. And I would like to think that we have evolved, and especially the military justice has evolved today, where we likely would not have seen the same result. The professor who penned my foreword in the book, Professor Korn, he talks a little bit about this and how military justice has come a long way from the days of the Buffalo soldiers. It's unfortunate that it takes these kinds of events for us to kind of realize where we've gone wrong and so forth. But it stands as a testimony of things that happened, things that we can look back upon and hope that we stay the course.
One thing that the city of Houston had the largest membership in the NAA, by 1922 had the second largest membership in the United States.
Yeah.
And I can't help but think Camp Logan affected that.
Oh, absolutely.
We have a question from our virtual audience. I'm enjoying tonight's discussion. Question: does the book deeply explore the Houston tragedy in the context to the reality of black life in 1917 during a time of extreme segregation, mass lynchings, black codes, and Jim Crow? This is from Dwight Burns.
What was the question again?
Okay. Does the book deeply explore this question, explore this Houston tragedy in the context of the reality of black life in 1917 during a time of extreme segregation, mass lynchings, black codes, and Jim Crow? This is signed by Dwight Burns, a local resident.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks for the question. The book does. In fact, one of the more unpleasant parts of the book is when I describe a very, you might say, well-known lynching, and it really brings to light what these events were, how incredibly brutal, grisly the treatment was for blacks who were lynched. So yes. Secondly, although these were black servicemen, they were Buffalo soldiers, their intersection with the white community in Houston illustrated what it was like to be just a black person in America at that time. And of course, as the writer mentioned, you do have the segregation, the Jim Crow laws, all these sorts of things. So it's really an interesting juxtaposition, because you have the victims who are soldiers, who are arguably in a somewhat higher social status than the local whites, but at the same time, they're being denigrated by the locals, by the system itself, by the streetcar, trolley drivers, and so forth. So it creates a really interesting mix, really kind of, I would describe it as a powder keg of things to go wrong.
Your book carefully documents what the question asked, and carefully documents that we had a powder keg and it just took one match to blow it up.
Yes.
And that, unfortunately, that match cost people their lives, both blacks and whites, either through being shot or being hung at the gallows. And nobody came out a winner.
Yes, correct. And that was really kind of one of the themes of my book, is the idea that there's not one particular side that comes out wearing the white hat in this. it's just kind of a sad event. And again, this might be one of the reasons why it's a little bit of a forgotten historical moment. Hopefully it won't be.
I was amazed that in your book you document how that was it Richardson that they told now the Buffalo Soldier officers, don't be mentioning, don't be talking about this when he got out of the hospital to go home,
right,
to go back to base.
Right.
They told him, don't be talking about this. Keep right. it low. Let's try to keep it quiet.
Right.
Everybody on all sides of the issue were trying to, you might say, sweep this under the rug.
Right.
And to me, that raises the question of honesty, how the failure to be honest and transparent contributed to the sparks that blew up the counter peg.
Yeah, that's a good analysis, and I would agree with that. I think their attempts to cover this up, their attempts to mitigate the damages, or before the riots, you had the police chief and the commanding officer of the 24th sort of talking to us, just saying, look, you know, I things aren't going really well. There could be some trouble. There was a failure of leadership on both or one of those individuals, and the events happened. But yeah, sloppiness and a failure to really kind of be honest about what was going on and what swift action could have been taken to nip this in the bud and keep it from turning into a really bad situation.
And what would that have been?
Handling the brutality of a rogue, or I should say two rogue cops, would have gone a long way to mitigate this. In fact, it might have even just prevented this. That leads to the question of a failure of leadership. The people in power, the decision makers, may have been sleeping at the wheel. Because on one side of the event, you've got folks who didn't rein in bad cops, and then on the other side, you had military leaders who allowed the mob hysteria to take over and to whip their troops into a frenzy.
Well, tell our audience where they can buy your book.
Right, it's on Amazon. It's on every major bookseller website. It should be in stores. I hope. I hope to see a few, at least locally in Dallas and Houston, and different parts. And they can find me on social media as well if they have any questions.
Did I see on Facebook that Walmart's carrying it?
Walmart's carrying my book. At least it's available on Walmart. I mean, how many books they have in stock? That's a different question. But
well, congratulations and thank you for joining us tonight. And thank you for your research. I know it's been a labor of love so far, but hopefully we're all a better country as a result, and we all can learn some lessons from the book. And it certainly is very intellectually stimulating and leaves a lot of questions to be asked. Although you attempted to answer them, more questions were asked.
Yeah, I'm happy just to get people talking about it. That's really kind of my motivation as a storyteller. Present the information. Talk about it with your friends and family, and we're better off all afterwards.
Thanks for coming.
My pleasure.